Hi, this is Robert Robertson, and this is the Registered Funds panel. So if you are here for Escape Room, that's a different panel later on. You are in for a real treat today. You should have a pen and paper right there with you. We're going to go over three rules that are a work in progress, and we're going to discuss the major issues that fund groups and attorneys face in trying to implement these new rules. So please have that pen and paper handy. Again, my name is Robert Robertson. I'm a partner here at Deckard. I also teach securities law at USC. One of my other panelists today, Phil Hinkle. He is a partner in our Washington, D.C. office. Good to see you, Phil. We also have Patrick Castellani. He is with Capital Group in Southern California. And lastly, but not least, Catherine McGregor. She is with Charles Schwab in Northern California. And Catherine is going to start us off by giving us a brief background of the fund-to-funds rule and some of the issues that she sees in implementing this new rule. Catherine?
Thank you, Robert. I'm sure most viewers today are familiar with Rule 12D1-4, the fund-to-funds rule. If it impacts your fund complex, it's something you're on top of and working your way through to meet the implementation date of January 19th, 2022. As we are here at Charles Schwab Investment Management. Otherwise, you've probably filed it away, and you can file this conversation away for the next few minutes as well. Today, I thought I'd give you an overview of the fund-to-funds rule in context of how we are working through it and implementing the rule for the Schwab funds and the Schwab ETFs. As part of the Schwab funds complex, CISA manages several fund-to-funds that invest both in proprietary and third-party mutual funds and ETFs. And we also manage mutual funds and ETFs that permit other funds to invest in them in excess of the Section 12D1A limits, the 3, 5, and 10 limits, as they're typically called. The Schwab funds had several exemptive orders that permitted these investment structures, which are going away with this new rule. So our first step was to understand what the new regulatory landscape would be for our funds. And it quickly became apparent that our target date series, which invests both in proprietary and third-party funds, would have to rely on the new rule. The fund-to-funds rule permits funds to invest over the 3, 5, and 10 limits, provided they meet certain requirements, including that the acquiring fund and its advisory group are prohibited from controlling a third-party fund, and where Section 2A9 of the Investment Company Act provides guidance on the presumption of control at over 25%. And it requires mere voting when you do exceed that 25% limit of a acquired fund by your acquiring fund and your advisory group. Over the years, CSIM has developed many asset allocation products that invest in mutual funds and ETFs, both in the investment company wrapper and in the separately managed account wrapper. And we also assist our bank and trust affiliates with managing collective investment trusts and trust accounts. So the rule required us to reevaluate what products and affiliates would be part of our investment advisory group or advisory group, whether there was any guidance that we could look to help us in that evaluation, particularly around the factors of control, and whether we would need to enhance our technology and reporting to gather the necessary information to undertake the monitoring for those limits. We did need to reevaluate our information barriers as well to make sure that the information was being monitored by the most appropriate group and that the necessary actions could be communicated and taken by the disparate portfolio management teams. As we reviewed the potential participants in the advisory group, particularly in light of our internal structures and the discussion of advisory group in the adopting the release, we came to the conclusion that most of our advisory products in the CSIM universe would be part of that advisory group. This is despite strict information barriers that we have in place around and between our portfolio management teams. In re-examining those information barriers, which is something I think everyone is going to need to do, we again took note of the adopting release and the acknowledgement that the definition of advisory group might specifically require that restructuring of investment barrier policies. So in light of our policies, we evaluated how and who would monitor the overall position in third-party funds across the advisory group. Did the how require a new technology build capabilities that we didn't currently have? Would there be upfront discussions between our asset allocation and third-party manager research teams on what funds could be both in SMAs and in fund-of-funds? And would we need separate approved lists for both SMAs and fund-of-funds? Different structures at your firm might result in different outcomes, but we are looking to our investment guidelines and compliance teams to be primarily responsible for monitoring and communicating on the overall holdings within our advisory group. The rule also requires investment advisors to both acquiring funds and acquired funds to make certain findings prior to investing and reporting, and then to report them to the board at the next regularly scheduled meeting. For acquired funds, the advisor needs to evaluate the complexity of the structure and the fees and expenses arising from the investment in an acquired fund, and find that the acquiring fund's fees and expenses are not duplicative of the fees and expenses of the acquired fund. This finding is very similar to what was required under prior exemptive relief, except that previously it was information that the advisor provided to the board making the finding. The Schwab funds have fund of funds that both do and do not have advisory fees at the acquired fund level. So this adds an additional variable that firms may have to also consider. We are also having discussions with our portfolio management and product teams to reevaluate and recast the information that we previously provided to the board to flush out the findings for required in this new rule. For an acquired fund, the investment advisor must address concerns about undue influence of an acquiring fund investment advisor, particularly considering things like the scale of the contemplated investments and any maximum limitations you might want to impose, anticipated timing of redemption requests, and potentially notification of those, whether and under what conditions the acquiring fund will provide advance notification, which I already said, and circumstances when a fund may satisfy the redemption requests in kind. We are looking at these findings not only for our Schwab ETFs, which already have several fund complexes that have signed participation agreements, but also for our Schwab funds. We had exemptive relief that permitted these types of investments in our Schwab funds, but never had too much interest under the old exemptive order regime. However, under the new rule, fund complexes that might not have been aware of this are now reaching out to other mutual funds and inquiring about making these types of investments. Again, in this context, we have engaged with portfolio management to look at the required findings and any other matters that are relevant to the fund to try and gather all that information in one place. We're also seeking to discuss whether there are any different considerations for mutual funds versus ETFs, given the ease that that ETFs have with the redemption in kind process that's not available to most mutual funds. We're also considering the 5% threshold beyond the 3% threshold and what impacts that might have for the operations of particular funds. And finally, we're thinking about whether we are not to have authorized participants to our ETFs provide us with information on who they might be in selling the funds to on the secondary market, and whether or not that can provide us with more visibility. We're hoping to build certain consistent findings up front with an acknowledgement that for particular fund investments, we might have to do specific time of purchase fund-specific findings as well. The hope is that would then ease the process for our board by providing them with more routine reporting as opposed to ad hoc quarterly reporting. It would be more annual reporting in that case. And we're in that process as well of drafting it. The discussion of findings leads to the final piece of the rule that I will discuss today, which is the requirement that funds that do not share an investment advisor enter into a fund-to-funds investment advisory agreement before the acquiring fund exceeds Section 12D1 limits. The agreement must be effective for so long as the fund relies on the rule and must contain any material terms needed to assist the fund in making its findings, a termination provision allowing either fund to terminate upon no more than 60 days written notice, provides the acquired fund to provide the acquiring fund with fees and expense information to the extent necessary to support those findings for the board, and agreements are required to be filed as a item with the registration statement. The Schwab funds previously had participation agreements required under its exemptive relief, both for the Schwab funds entering into and acquiring other funds in excess of the limits, and also for our Schwab ETFs. And our funds had also signed other third-party ETF participation agreements. So like many in the industry, we are gathering the information from our prior agreements, from our competitors' agreements that we have seen, and from industry standards, and trying to come together with the best agreement that covers all the issues that we want for our portfolio management team, our liquidity risk management team, and our investment risk team to have to make monitoring of our funds, investments, and investments in our funds thorough and in the best interest of the funds. We have received inquiries on this and are reaching out to those who have sent us agreements before, hoping to repaper all of our agreements. The process seems to be going fairly smoothly, other than once we got over the hump of the defining the advisory group. So, Catherine, can
you talk a little bit more about the due diligence process where your funds might support insurance products and the certification that an insurance company has to make?
So we haven't received too many requests from insurance companies as yet, but to the extent that their requests were reasonable to support their due diligence in understanding our investments and our underlying components of our funds, I think if we were interested in having them invest in our funds, we would support those requirements with them. Certain of our funds have limitations on how much they will do in other investment companies, and certain of them don't. So those are factors that people can see in our documentation.
Does it, from Schwab's perspective or your perspective, does this rule seem worth it? This seems like a lot of effort. Do you think you're going to end up in a better place than where we are now?
Since we had exemptive orders in the Schwab family for each of these types of arrangements, for both our mutual funds buying other people's mutual funds and ETFs in excess of the order, for people to buy to acquire our ETFs or our mutual funds, which are very similar to the requirements under those exemptive orders, that are very similar to what's required under the rule, it doesn't really change the playing field that much for us. It just really recasts it. For other fund complexes that didn't have that flexibility, hadn't previously received exemptive orders, they probably opens up a new portal for them. So for them, it's changing the field. For us, it's really just repapering and reprocessing the existing field.
Thank you very much, Catherine. Phil, why don't we turn it to you now to give us a brief overview of this new derivatives rule and some of the major issues that you see with respect to implementation.
Sure. Thanks, Robert. Thanks, Catherine. That was so interesting. So I'm sure many of you are already very familiar with new Rule 18F4, which was adopted at the end of last year, became effective in February of this year, and requires compliance on August 19th of next year. And as you know, I'm sure, this new rule will wipe away the current asset segregation framework for derivatives that has been used since the 1970s and before under a patchwork of SEC and staff guidance. So while I'm sure many of you are very familiar with the basic elements of the rule, I'll just give a quick highlight of the core parts to make sure we're all on the same page, and then dig into a few implementation issues that we've been seeing people think about as the compliance date comes barreling down the road and is only less than a year away at this point in time. So this rule provides an exemption from the restrictions under Section 18 on funds that invest in derivatives and various other kinds of transactions, including reverse repurchase agreements and similar financing transactions like TOB trusts, unfunded commitments, and certain when issued securities and other similar kinds of forward settling securities. It's very detailed and tortuous in how it deals with the various different categories of rules. So it requires a lot of assessment and careful thinking about how the rule will impact a fund and its investments. So just to dig into the various portions of the rule that apply to funds. So for funds that invest in derivatives transactions, there's a category of funds that will be impacted on a kind of light basis called limited derivatives users that can avoid the more complex conditions of the rule. In order to do so, they have to adopt policies and procedures reasonably designed to manage their derivatives risks, and also comply with a 10% cap on derivatives exposure with certain exceptions. Now, for those funds that use derivatives and can't comply with the limited derivatives user conditions, those funds need to comply with a whole slew of other conditions. And those include adopting a derivatives risk management program with 6 components, which I'll talk a little bit about later, complying with a value at risk or VAR-based limit on fund leverage risk that compares the fund's value at risk to the value at risk of a designated reference portfolio, which could be an index of the fund's own securities portfolio, or for one that can't find a designated reference index that's appropriate, which is a big ball of wax in and of itself, those funds can comply with an absolute VAR test. For funds that invest in certain forward settling securities, they can do so without those transactions being treated as a derivatives transaction and certain similar kinds of forward securities, as long as those securities are intended to be settled and settle within 35 days. So moving on from the derivatives transactions, reverse repurchase agreements and similar financing transactions present funds a choice. They can either determine to treat those transactions as indebtedness and aggregate them with other indebtedness like cash borrowings, or they can treat those instruments as derivatives transactions and manage those transactions under their derivatives risk management program or count them towards the derivatives exposure limit for limited derivatives users. And then finally, funds that invest in unfunded commitment agreements, which are agreements to lend money to a company at some point in time, those funds need to develop a reasonable belief at the time that they enter into an unfunded commitment that it will have sufficient assets, liquid assets, to meet its requirements, obligations under the unfunded commitments and all of its other unfunded commitments at the time that they come due, generally codifying the approach that was ironed out with the SEC staff through the disclosure review process by the BDC industry. So in addition to all of those substantive requirements, there are a bunch of board reporting, SEC reporting, and record keeping requirements that also will need to be dealt with. So let's get into some of the issues that people are thinking about. And I'll just give you a few, and Robert, feel free to jump in and tell me that we're hitting our time here. So one thing that needs to be thought about is, how does this fit into the fund's compliance program? And generally, funds will need to adopt a 38A1 compliance procedure for compliance with the rule that would be a high-level kind of black letter description of what the rule is and a policy to comply with it, depending on the kind of fund that you have at hand. And then also to adopt desk-level procedures for limited derivatives users or full compliance funds that for each of them encapsulate the policies and procedures for management of the derivatives risks and also the derivatives risk management program, and also for full compliance funds, probably a procedure for compliance with the VAR tests and all the other myriad requirements throughout the rule.
Just on that particular point, what do you think is the ratio between 38A1 procedures versus desktop procedures? So, I mean, do you see 38A1 procedures being 2 pages, 3 pages, the desktop operating procedures being 6 pages, 7 pages? So what's the ratio of these two items?
Sure. So if you have just limited derivatives users, you might be able to squeeze the 38A1 procedure into something that's just a couple pages and then describe how you're managing derivatives risks, probably through derivatives risk guidelines process light in a kind of, you know, 6-page or 8-page document that's a desk procedure. If you're doing all of the different components of the rule, your just black letter description of the rule and policy to comply with it will probably be 10, 12 pages, something like that. This rule is complicated. And then your derivatives risk management program, depending on how you decide to list out and what level of detail you decide to list out, your practices could be anywhere from like 10 to 50 pages. So another thing that people are thinking about a lot about as we're coming close to the rule compliance date is how do we talk about our progress with the funds board and start to socialize the program elements that the funds are using with trustee council. And a number of our clients have been engaging in kind of teach-in sessions and taking this as an opportunity to discuss with their boards the kinds of derivatives that are actually being used by the various range of funds within the complex and how VAR and the concept of VAR and stress testing applies to those funds, almost in a way that's disconnected from the actual rule elements, but just kind of describing the substance of these very complicated subjects. And I think that's helping boards come to grips with their role of oversight, which is generally for a full compliance fund, relying on the derivatives risk manager, which they have to appoint to administer the derivatives risk management program to actually do the nuts and bolts of doing the derivatives risk management. But it's important to keep in mind timing and making sure that the fund group's working group for implementation of Rule 18F4 leaves enough time to get their full thoughts together and socialize it with the board and have the board approve the derivatives risk manager and any other kinds of approvals that the fund group decides to request prior to August 2022. I know we don't have much more time, but a couple of other things that people are really struggling with a bit is one of the elements of the derivatives risk management program is the fund has to put in place risk guidelines, which I kind of hinted at a minute ago. Those risk guidelines under the rule are contemplated as having measurable criteria over which the fund normally will not go for various types of derivatives risks, including leverage, market risk, payment obligations, which the SEC calls liquidity risk, but also more soft risks like legal risk and operational risk. And so while the rule kind of contemplates putting in place sort of hard limits or criteria, some of those guidelines necessitate having processes in place that will manage the risks. And the SEC in the adopting release did acknowledge that that may be the case. While that sounds kind of simple when you say it, like I just did, every fund group has to kind of go through the process of assessing what they currently have in place that manage these kinds of different risks and identifying how to tweak them in order to isolate derivatives or otherwise get to a point where the derivatives risk manager and the rest of the fund's risk group is satisfied that they're appropriately addressing the rule. And it's really seeming to be kind of the hardest part of the rule from a group think perspective to get through. So another kind of consideration that other fund groups are thinking about is you've got to really spend a lot of time categorizing the instruments that the funds invest in. And there are a number of instruments that the industry is kind of grappling with to create forward payment obligations. And the industry generally is thinking carefully about how to bucket them, whether they're truly unfunded commitment agreements, whether they're a forward settling security that fits within the forward settling security exemption, which is kind of the best option from a compliance standpoint, or whether they're actually derivatives transactions that count towards the fund's derivatives. So that's something that takes a lot of thought and careful assessment of various fund holdings. And also necessitates putting in place a process for consideration of new instruments as time goes along to make sure that they're appropriately categorized as well.
Bill, before you go on to your next item, why don't we put up our first polling question to see where the audience is with respect to implementation of the derivatives rule. See how you're doing. And Phil, please proceed. I do have a question for you, but please proceed.
I don't see the question on our screen, but do you want to read it out loud?
I don't see it either. I'm sure it'll pop up in a second.
Okay. So another kind of basic consideration relates to the VAR test and what kind of benchmark or lack thereof is appropriate for each of the funds in the fund group. And many funds, and just to rewind for a minute, the benchmark that the fund generally needs to compare itself to for the VAR test, which requires that the fund's value at risk or VAR be no more than 200% of the value at risk of its designated reference portfolio, is very careful. The designated reference portfolio is very carefully defined under the SEC rule. And it requires that it either be an unleveraged index or be the fund's own securities portfolio. In either case, it has to be reflective of the asset classes and markets in which the fund invests, and the derivatives risk manager has to make a reasonable determination in order not to use one of those two options as a designated reference portfolio, that it would not be appropriate based on the kinds of investment strategies and objectives of the fund. So that, again, sounds like it might be a kind of easy determination, but it's a very fact-specific and intensive analysis, and there has to be justification written in a board report at the implementation of the program and then on an annual basis. So careful thought really needs to go into whether you can rule an index and then the fund securities portfolio out as an appropriate designated reference portfolio. So Robert, did we get that?
Yes, question? Well, I see that the polling answers are in, and 14% of the audience, they just formed their working group. So, you know, okay. The good news is 77% are doing well. They're on a good timeline. So,
and the good news for that 13% is it's not till August 2022, but
they're coming
along. You have time.
You know, Phil, a question I have before we turn to Patrick is, one of the issues I see is that you want firms, you know, and clients to be right at where market is. You know, you don't want them to overshoot it or undershoot it. So if everyone has desktop, you know, procedures that are 35 pages, you don't want yours to be 4 pages. You don't want yours to be 60 pages. I mean, how are you just approaching this? I know you're just doing the best you can, but I just see that it's because this stuff is not public, it's hard to figure out where market is.
Yeah, I think that's a great question, Robert. And that's one of the places to make a shameless plug where law firms or compliance firms can come in, help, and help funds kind of assess where they are. Then also, the ICI Working Group has been a great resource for numerous of our clients that I've heard about, in helping them kind of think through whether they're hitting the industry benchmark with respect to whatever it is that they're selecting for risk guidelines and other things. And the ICI has been engaging in a lot of really constructive surveys and other activities, in my understanding.
Thank you very much, Phil. And Patrick, why don't we turn to you now to discuss the new valuation rule.
Great. Thanks so much. And I'm going to go over a very similar format to how Phil went over 18 at 4. I'll do a short overview of the SEC Rule 285 and then go over some relevant topics that I'm hearing are kind of work in progress issues around the industry and what some of the significant discussion points are around those topics. So for the rule overview, 2A5's real simple goal is to ensure funds' assets are valued properly, and it establishes a regulatory framework for fund valuation policies and practices to determine fair value in good faith. The rule was finalized in March of 2021, with compliance required by September 8, 2022, and it's the first overarching valuation rule in over 50 years. The rule rescinds prior SEC and staff guidance on fair value, such as ASR 113 and 118, and many letters over the years. And the scope of the rule is all registered funds and BDCs. So what does the rule say? What are some basics of the rule? So the rule allows fund boards to formally designate fair value determinations to a valuation designee, which is generally expected to be the fund's investment advisor, while also ensuring the board has active oversight of that designee. The rule defines now what's called readily available market quotations, which is a real pivot point for many changes related to valuation, oversight of vendors, board's oversight of valuation, reporting, as well as the fund's ability to cross-trade fixed income assets, which I'll touch on a bit more later. The definition of readily available market quotations, I'm not going to quote it here, but it essentially makes all fixed income assets that are vendor priced to be considered fair valued under the new rule, which brings a whole new set of obligations into oversight for that set of assets. And then the basic framework. So what is the framework to determine fair value in good faith? And there's a few categories. First, you need to periodically assess and manage valuation risks. You need to establish, apply, and test fair value methodologies, and establish a process for oversight and evaluation of your pricing services. Finally, before I go into some of the work in progress items, Rule 31A4 was also established along with 2A5 for record keeping requirements. This separate rule essentially is related to maintaining appropriate documentation to support fair value determinations, and it creates the space for record-keeping violations to not be considered a violation of 2A5, and therefore not imply that the board hasn't determined fair value in good faith simply because of a record-keeping violation. So moving on to the work in progress issues, and I'm going to go through three and a half or four. I'm going to go over, three, I called it three and a half, but four kind of work in progress issues. And I say three and a half to four because it's board reporting, which also includes the new element of prompt reporting. So two kind of reporting elements, vendor due diligence, and what changes need to happen there with regards to establishing a process for oversight and evaluation of your pricing services. And then, as I mentioned earlier, cross trading of fixed income and how this will be impacted by the rules compliance date. So starting with board reporting, just general, and there's multiple elements of board reporting as noted in the rule: annual, quarterly, ad hoc, and then prompt, which again will be another topic just in a few minutes. So the annual and quarterly reports must include what's called material matters, which are loosely defined in footnote 247 of the rule to be similar to material compliance matters in Rule 38A1. And although they're not fully defined in 2A5, some material matters might include items such as conflicts of interest, changes in a pricing service, a pattern of challenges to one vendor or overrides of a particular vendor's asset types or pricing, and then material changes in fair value methodologies. In terms of prompt reporting, this is the newest element. This must occur within 5 days of identification of a material matter. And material matters are defined even more, a little bit more differently here, where there's two elements of material matters. First, when there's a material error in NAV calculations. And second, when there's a significant deficiency or material weakness in the design or effectiveness of your fair value determination process. So with both of those two elements, I imagine there's going to be some diversity of practice here across the industry. And first, how do you define a material error in NAV? Or you can use 50 basis points, one penny. Both of those are noted in the rule as being reasonable. Maybe you use some combination of the two or something totally different. On top of that, there's also the non-NAV related aspects, which include those significant deficiencies or material weaknesses in your processes. This is a definite discussion point at Capital Group, one that we're trying to align on when a significant deficiency would occur and how quickly we can actually get that in front of our boards, which again, the rule states 5 business days.
Let me interrupt you again.
Sure.
So I hear those terms when I go to audit committee meetings, you know, significant deficiencies, material weaknesses. Is this the same standard?
We believe so, yeah. We've talked about that, and I think it's very important to talk to audit shops about this and align on how you're going to define this for the prompt reporting. So we do believe so, yep. So just to keep on the prompt reporting, there was a recent industry survey, and I'm going to quote a few stats from it, where only about 30% of shops indicated that they have a system in place today to communicate material matters to their boards within 5 days. So not a huge number. And only about half of the shops surveyed indicated that they strictly use a change in NAV as what constitutes a material issue for their boards. So Robert, going back to your question, that really leaves open the significant deficiencies and material weaknesses for definition at each fund shop and ensuring there's a process around providing that prompt reporting when that does occur. The next topic I was going to touch on is vendor due diligence and how might this change with 2A5? How might you have to think differently about fourth party vendor oversight? And to be honest, I believe most fund shops that I interact with and Capital as well have always had processes around vendor oversight, controls around due diligence meetings, meeting with their vendors regularly, and then usually generally yearly on site. So I think most shops probably have met a lot of the requirements of the rule in their standard processes, although small enhancements are going to happen to make sure there's no missing elements of oversight and ensure very strong documentation of your process, documenting the vendor methodologies on pricing at different asset types, as well as documenting a process around your price challenges to those vendors. Within this vendor due diligence section, I think an interesting concept is a discussion point we've had internally at Capital is thinking about what is a source versus a service within a vendor. So for example, a source might be somebody that supplies you with market data. Maybe it doesn't directly create your evaluation at the end of the day, but it supports an evaluation or it's part of an evaluation. Whereas a service is really supplying you with a true evaluated price where you rely on their expertise. So I think an interesting discussion point here to have is how much due diligence do you need to complete on services that supply you with inputs and sources that supply you with inputs and services that supply you with prices. And finally, cross-trading, which is impacted by the rule given the new definition of readily available market quotations, which could essentially make fixed income harder or ineligible for cross-trading. Rule 17A7, we hear, is being looked at by the SEC based on concerns given the new definition in Rule 2A5. But without any regulatory changes or guidance, this is definitely a turning point and should be discussed within your shops about the possibility that cross-trading fixed income could look very different post 2A5 compliance date. So I guess I'm looking at time. I'm probably going close to over. So I'll just reiterate the four that I touched on that I think are some of the bigger items are our board reporting with prompt reporting being in there as well. Vendor due diligence, and then cross-trading of fixed income. And Robert, just one more touch point I wanted to mention, that there is a significant amount of discussion around the industry about technology changes related to 2A5 rule, and essentially it being a catalyst for a lot of shops to start generating automated reports and aggregating data for board reporting. And this has come up on a couple of calls I've been on. So I just wanted to mention it. It's not related to actually being compliant with the rule, but a lot of shops are taking this opportunity to increase and improve their data as well as their reporting on top of that data for their boards. So I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Patrick. Why don't we put up our last poll dealing with implementing the valuation rule? And while that's up, now for the last couple minutes, I'm going to talk about board diversity. What prompted this is that in July, an SEC advisory subcommittee recommended disclosure with respect to gender and minority diversity for fund boards. It's a recommendation to the SEC. Who knows where this is going to go? But a month after that recommendation, the SEC approved new NASDAQ listing requirements, which you know you may have heard about, and starting next proxy season for operating companies that trade on NASDAQ, and think Apple, Microsoft, Amazon, that they will be required to include a little chart. And that chart will lay out at the board level gender diversity and demographic diversity. And as part of the gender diversity, you have male, female, non-binary. And for the demographic diversity, it will be the usual suspects of African-American, Hispanic, Asian, also including LGBTQ. After a couple-year transition period, NASDAQ-listed companies will be required to say whether they met a particular objective. And that objective will be that you have to have at least two diverse directors. That's one female and one underrepresented minority. And so there will be a brief transition period. So you have to disclose that you've met that requirement or explain why you have not met that requirement. And when my assistant was typing up my notes, she said, well, Robert, what would be a good excuse as to why you don't have women on your board? And I said, I don't know, maybe, you know, some Taliban company or something like that. But anyway, that is going to be the NASDAQ requirement. There are about 12 states that have disclosure requirements for operating company boards. About 12 states, their disclosure requirements. There's one exception, California. In California, if you are an operating company that is publicly traded, that means you're filing 34 Act filings, that is publicly traded, and you have your principal place of business in California, you are required to have a certain number of women on your board and a certain number of underrepresented minorities. And there's a little schedule for it. So the bigger the board, the more you have, more directors you have, there's a schedule for the number of women and underrepresented minorities. This is a legal requirement. It is not just disclosure. And a company can be fined up to $100,000 if they don't meet these requirements. Something that I will say as I reflected on this, I've been around a while, but not that long. And I will tell you, Catherine, Phil, Patrick, I started out my career across the street at a different law firm. And in 1987, so I've been around a little while, you know, not too long. And when I started at that other law firm, there were no other African-American attorneys. And this was in the top four of LA law firms. No other African-American attorneys. There were no Hispanic attorneys, none. this is Los Angeles. If I walked across the street to the California Club, Catherine, women were not allowed as members. Remember that? When I went to the SEC in Washington, D.C., I had staff attorneys whose parents belonged to clubs that would not allow women or Hispanics or African Americans. For gays, you couldn't be in the Army. You could not serve in the Army if you were gay. You would be dishonorably discharged. And Don't Ask, Don't Tell, of course, which is nutso, didn't come until 94. So you think about how far we've come to actually encouraging diversity on boards. So I'll just tell you, when I'm talking to younger people, they think, oh, the world's always been like this. No, actually, we've come a long way. We have further to go. And as I talk about these issues, I usually see half the room smiling, half the room thinking, oh my goodness, this is all crazy. But nonetheless, there you are. Corp Fin will be proposing a rule relating to diversity disclosure and operating company boards, okay? We will see if IM is going to piggyback on Corp Fin's rule. Who knows? Maybe IM will take a pass. Maybe there'll be, you know, a footnote or a couple of pages about what about mutual funds. I don't see a logical distinction between mutual funds and operating companies, but we will see. Now, if you'd like to discuss any of these issues, we're going to have a breakout panel. And if you just want to discuss philosophy, we'll do that too. So we'll have a breakout panel discussion group for about 10 minutes. Please hang in there to the very end. We have ESG coming up. After that, we have closing remarks. We've hired an entire orchestra to close out our program. So with that, we'll talk to you soon.